Welcome again, as Lois said, and we want to begin our program with a libation.
For my youth who represent our future. For our people, the original people.
Who's one of the co-people on this committee, who has been here in Sarasota, so I'm in Ohio for the year. And so Mydahlia Glover has been here in Sarasota on the ground, making sure that everything has happened, along with Melanie Lavender, who's another member of the committee. Without Mydahlia and Melanie, this would not be happening.
This is a cultural celebration. So it doesn't matter what your faith is, your denomination. This is about the community coming together, all on one accord in unity, to celebrate, to learn, to understand, and to honor each other. But having said that, it is rooted in the African history as well as the African culture. And that would be in the first fruit celebration. Dr. Karenga, who created this celebration back in the early 60s, wanted to bring the people together in California after having dealt with a very traumatic experience.
This holidays was about bringing together the community. It was about healing. It was about honoring. I wanted to make sure we talked about these symbols that you see on the table. And so you will always start the Kwanzaa display with a mat, Mekeka. So the Mekeka is here, it represents the foundation. You have the Kanara, which represents our African roots. You have the candles, and each of the candles represents the seven principles of Kwanzaa. And the Mishumas Saba, right, which are the seven candles. The black candle represents the people. The red candle represents the struggle. The green candle represents the hope that comes after the struggle. These are the Pan-African colors, right? And if you know anything about the movement, Pan-African movement, it has a long history of a movement of global black movement of people sort of recognizing the common struggle and the need to work together. And so we have to give thanks and honor Marcus Garvey, right, and the Universal Negro Improvement Association for these red, black, and green colors. And so Umoja, unity, Kujijakulia, self-determination, Ujima, collective work and responsibility, Ujama, cooperative economics, Nia, purpose, Kuumba, creativity, and Imani, faith. Those are the seven principles. And each one of these principles, Karenga attached each one of these principles to an African philosophy, right? A different philosophical system from a different group around the continent. So I encourage all of you to go and do that research. So the mazo, or the crops, represent the harvest and the results of our collective wealth, our collective work. Muhindi, or the corn, symbolize the youth and our future. Kikomba cha Umoja is the unity cup, and it symbolizes the togetherness that is necessary for transformational collective action, right? Transformational collective action to change, to improve, to better the conditions, the experiences of black folks around the world. And then the Zawadi are the gifts, and they represent the work and love of parents and caregivers to develop the next generation.
Right. You have all heard the word community, and it's quite understandable. Unity, of course, is the root of community. So how appropriate that our Manasota ASALA Freedom School gets this opportunity to talk Freedom School, to introduce to those who don't know what we're trying to do in the community around the Freedom School. Lois mentioned the tradition of Freedom Schools, and I want to just take a few minutes to provide that background, because it is ancient. It is ancient as Africa is ancient. The idea that enslaved people gain skills is such an absurdity. I won't spend another second on it, but I will remind you that Africans came to this country unwillingly, but came with those skills.
Right.
And if there's any question about that, we can talk later. The concept of community education could not be more fundamental to that tradition. The griot, the storyteller, telling the ancient stories that all of the different varied African societies would have kept and cherished. That wasn't lost in the Middle Passage, as horrible as that experience was. So Africans have always had that commitment to education, and that wasn't lost despite the horrors of enslavement in this country. The Freedmen's Bureau, just because we're playing with words, so Freedom Schools, the Freedmen's Bureau was created after the Civil War, and it was created to obviously assist freedmen and women coming out of enslavement to survive in the most hostile environments you can imagine. It was America's answer to this almost 400 years of enslavement. It was an inadequate answer, but it was an effort to educate, to feed, to clothe formerly enslaved men, women, and one of the most important things they did was to create schools. Freedmen Bureau schools that did exactly that. They ultimately would close after the Freedmen's Bureau was dissolved and Jim Crow would have forced those education-seeking black folks back into almost slavery. Fast forward to the Civil Rights era. I just want to remind us that the Freedom Schools we're talking about today started in the 1960s as young folks, some the ages of you here, traveled from their universities to the South, working with the various agencies that made up the civil rights leadership, and they were teaching. Yes, they were teaching voter education and how to register and how to protect yourself when you're trying to exercise your rights to vote. But they were also teaching reading and writing and counting, and because black folks needed those skills to exist. And so 1964, the Freedom Summer particularly, was maybe the pinnacle of that era. Thousands of these schools existed in churches, in backyards, in community centers. And so as we come to this challenge of today, the threat to the integrity of our history, by our governor, by the legislature, it wasn't my idea. My dear wife is being generous. It was the idea from our national ASALA office to go back to teaching our children the way we've always taught our children, Saturday school. And so that's the genesis of this concept of Freedom Schools. And we intend to do that until the schools do what they are by law required to do. Now, many of us understand that it has been the state law in the state of Florida for more than 20 years that African and African American history be taught K through 12, that it is required instruction. So we're not letting that go. This is not a replacement for that. We insist that be taught just as other subjects are being taught, and we'll continue to protest against the denial of that education to our children. But our Freedom School today is in place, and I'm proud to look around and see. Our kids have been studying Kwanzaa since the beginning of December. They've been studying, all of them, K through 12, been studying ancient Africa as the first part of this second phase of our Freedom School. And so I'm going to sit down.
Hooray! Hooray!